Hey everyone, Patrick CK here with part 7 of my guide to help make the transition from SketchUp to Blender. Although this one is more of a general Blender tutorial than anything, as we're moving out of the scope of SketchUp's capabilities. In SketchUp, if you wanted to put a different material on top of another, you typically would have to manually add it to the main texture in a photo editor, or cut out a smaller face from the main face of your model and apply the material to the newly formed face, or add a photo object and just line it up with the model. Funny enough, you can do all this in Blender too, but of course Blender offers a more comprehensive system that's more versatile. Let's pick up right where we left off and start to explore Blender's material node system. The node system is a massive part of Blender's workflow. While you could get along with just adding colors and materials like we've done up to now, it behooves you to play around with this part of Blender. You can get some amazing results verging on photorealism. Today though, we'll start with the basics, but still accomplish something you can't duplicate in SketchUp, adding multiple images to one face. We will utilize a new editor window for this tutorial. From the editor type menu of the lower pane, select Shader Editor. This window is where we'll be putting together our material node setups. When you first visit the screen, you'll see two of the default nodes, the principled BSDF node, which we are already familiar with, and the material output node, which simply tells Blender where to apply the material. This is usually the last node that everything else ultimately connects to in most setups. Quick note about nodes, the connection points on the left of each node are inputs, and those on the right are outputs. Of course, outputs connect to inputs and vice versa. Some nodes allow multiple connections out of one output, but typically only one connection can be made per input. Adding nodes is the same as when working with a model. The shortcut Shift plus A will bring up the Add Node menu, where you can look for the node you need or do a search if you already know its name. There are almost 90 nodes available. Each one performs a different function or set of functions. You can string multiple nodes together to create complex and interesting effects for each material. This is a drag and drop interface. You can move individual nodes or select a group of them and move them all at once. You can also minimize each node to better organize your workspace, as these setups can get pretty elaborate and start to look like spaghetti and meatballs. Let's start by going through how to add a transparent image on top of a flat color. First, insert a new cube. Since it's already unwrapped, we won't have to worry about doing that part. Then create a new material and apply it to the cube like before. But instead of swapping out the base color for an image texture, as we did last time, we'll do it in the shader editor. This time, all you have to do is drag and drop the image from your computer onto the shader editor window. This will automatically create the image node and select the image you just dropped in. That's the easy way. You can also bring up the add menu by pressing Shift and A, then under texture, select image texture. Place the node down, click open, navigate to the location of the image, and select open. So yeah, drag and drop is much faster. Set the repeat option to clip so that only one instance of the image will appear. For this setup, you don't need the default principled BSDF node, so simply select it and press X or the delete key to remove it. Next, we are going to add a mix RGB node. Press Shift and A. Then under color, select Mix RGB. Then place it between the image node and the material output node. All we have to do now is connect these three nodes together. From the image node, connect the color output to the color 2 input of the mix node. To do this, press and hold the left mouse button on the output connection and drag it until you hit the input on the next node. You could also go from the input to the output if you prefer that way. I won't judge. Then, because this image is transparent, it has an alpha channel. So we want to connect the alpha output of the image node to the FAC, short for factor, input of the mix node. you'll see that the factor slider has disappeared. That's because the alpha channel tells Blender where we'll see our image versus the background color, which we can set by clicking the color picker and again either manually choosing a color or inputting a color code below. Lastly, once we connect the color output from the mix node to the surface input of the material output node, we will see it in our model above. We can go back and adjust the background color or go into the UV editor to move our image. If you don't see anything, make sure you are in material preview mode. So this is how you add a single transparent image on top of a face. Here's where things get interesting. We can add even more images on top of this face and layer them as we like by using just a few more types of nodes. We'll stick with the material we've already started working on. We'll use the first image as a background. To do this, switch out the transparent image for a solid one and swap the input on the mix RGB from color 2 to color 1 by dragging and dropping the connection points. Remove the alpha connection by dragging the input off of the node and letting it go in empty space. The image may look a little off until we add the next image. If you need to adjust the UV map, do so now as it will become trickier later. With that done, we'll start adding more images. Drag and drop another image, just like before, and set repeat to clip. To the left of the image node, we'll add two more types of nodes: the texture coordinate node and the mapping node. These two tell Blender what texture system we're using and how to position the image, respectively. Since we're using the UV map that's already there, we want to go from the UV output of the texture coordinate node to the vector input on the mapping node, and then connect the vector output from the mapping node to the vector input of the image node. Now we'll mix these images together. Connect the alpha output from the second image node to the factor of the mix node, and the color from the image node to color 2 of the mix node. Now we can go back to the mapping node and adjust our settings, including location, rotation, and scale to get it just where we want on the face. The reason we're using the mapping node to move and adjust the image instead of moving the face itself within the UV editor is because we are working with multiple graphics on one face. So if you were to move the face in the UV editor, it looks like everything moves. Of course, if you want to use this method for just one image, you are absolutely free to do so. To add the next image, we start with duplicating the second setup. Pull in the image, add the texture coordinate node, then the mapping node, and lastly, the mix RGB node. This time, the output of the first mix RGB node will go to color 1 input of the new mix RGB node, and the alpha output from the third image goes to the factor input, the second mix node, and the color goes to color 2. Lastly, the output of the new mix node will go into the surface input of the material output node. Following along? Good! You may be wondering how you know where to connect each output and input. And honestly, it's trial and error, and looking up how other people did it. You can use this same setup to add as many images as you want to the same face. Just remember to always connect the last mix RGB node to the material output node. After doing this a few times already, we can add one more in a snap. And there we go, 4 graphics on one face. Now we can go back at any time and adjust the settings as needed. We can also rearrange the nodes and change the order of the layers, their positions and or orientations. Even though we have 14 nodes and a noodle of connections, we only technically used 4 types of nodes. You also don't have to arrange the nodes like I did. You could put them wherever you like, as long as the connections are the same. Again, this is a very basic node setup. Just imagine the kind of results we can get once we start connecting more varieties of nodes together. We'll get a little hint of that in the next part. Just a quick tip, by default, when you connect nodes together, the lines are perfectly straight. If you'd like them to curve like mine, go to the Edit menu. Then Preferences. In the Preferences window, select Themes. Then from the list, select Node Editor. Scroll past all the color options to where it says Noodle Curving. By default, it's 0, but if you start to increase this value, you'll see your straight lines start to curve. The higher the number, the more extreme the curve. I prefer it at 4, but you do you. That's it for this episode. Now that we know how to add our own images and play around with the node system, in the next tutorial, we'll combine what we've learned with some slightly more advanced node setups to get some really cool effects. I hope this has helped you out. If it did, please leave a like and share so others can find this content in the future. Until next time, this has been Patrick CK. Goodbye.